Morrow and Harper Audio present The Moon, the Stars, and Madame Burova, a novel by Ruth Hogan, performed by Nina Wadia.
Never tell a secret, never tell a lie. If you break a promise, you will surely die. Say your prayers at bedtime, God forgive your sin. Then when you get to heaven, the angels let you in. The Promise. Madame Burova was a woman who knew where the bodies were buried. She had spent a lifetime keeping other people's secrets, and her silence had come at a price. Some revelations, forbidden affairs, and minor indiscretions had been easy enough to bear, like feathers on the wind. But others, dark and disturbing, had pricked her conscience and been a burden on her soul. She had seen the lovers and the liars, the angels and the devils, the dreamers and the fools. Her cards had unmasked them all, and her cards never lied. Madame Burova knew the killer, the victim, and the murder weapon. Outside, the warm late summer twilight was smudged with soft thumbprints of light from the illumination strung along the promenade. High season was coming to an end, but for now the screams and squeals of excitement from the funfair still carried on the wind, soprano notes duetting with the baritone of the waves booming onto the beach and rattling the pebbles as they slunk back into the sea. Madame Burova, tarot reader, palmist, and clairvoyant, proclaimed the painted sign on the front of the booth where she had been duckering, as her Romany mother always called it, for over 50 years. Today had been her swan song. Madame Burova was retiring, reluctantly, sadly, but inevitably. Her mind was still sharp and her gift as infallible as ever. But she was weary of other people's lives, their questions, their problems, and their secrets. She needed rest and a little piece of life for herself while she still had the chance. She sat down in a chair beside a small round gypsy table covered with a velvet cloth, where her crystal ball stood next to a silver-framed photograph of her long-dead, beloved Borzoi, Grisha. The rings on her fingers flashed and sparkled as she picked up two brown envelopes. She had been entrusted as their guardian and had kept their secrets safe and silent for all these years. She turned them over in her hands, the hands that had held countless others and read the future in their palms. The envelopes held a secret that had troubled Madame Burova more than most, and now the time had come for her to open them and fulfill a promise made long ago. Chapter 1. 1972. Imelda Burova checked her appearance in the bedroom mirror and was satisfied. So was Rod Stewart. "You wear it well," he sang, his voice rasping out from the small radio sitting on her dressing table. The dress, a green velvet midi with a fitted bodice and balloon sleeves, was Bieber, and had been bought especially for today on her last trip to London with her mother, Shanti May. Today was Imelda's first day as proprietress of the family's duckering booth on the promenade. Shanti May had taken it over from her own mother, and it was there that she had taught Imelda to read palms and tarot cards and to fathom the past and future from the depths of a crystal ball. Various Romany aunts and cousins had helped out for a summer season here and there, but the booth belonged to Shanti May, and now she was handing it over to her only daughter. Today, Imelda became Madame Burova, tarot reader, palmist, and clairvoyant. She drew back the curtains to let the early morning sunlight stream in. Shanti May was in the back garden by the open door of her caravan, smoking a cigarette and cursing. Now in her early 70s, she was still an extraordinarily striking woman, with sea-green eyes and only wispers of silver in her long black hair. She had left her travelling life behind when she married Imelda's father, Alexei, but had flatly refused to give up her traditional gypsy vado and insisted on keeping it in the garden. Whenever she and Alexei rowed, she stormed off to the vado and often slept there. Imelda could hear the clatter of pots and pans and her father whistling in the kitchen downstairs as he prepared to cook breakfast. He had a fiery temper that was easily a match for Shanti May's passionate outbursts, But whereas his anger was quickly spent and soon forgotten, his wife's could sometimes smoulder like hot coals and flare again at the slightest provocation. Alexei was a successful tailor with his own shop, but a gorger, a non-Romany, and Shanti May's family had objected vehemently and vocally when their courtship was discovered. The pair had eventually eloped, and faced with a fait accompli, the Romany relatives grudgingly accepted the marriage. Their love for one another was immutable, but their life together a volatile alliance of disparate cultures and traditions. There was a groan from beneath the rumpled covers of Imelda's bed, and a long, pointed nose appeared. "Get up, you lazy hound!" Two soulful brown eyes and a pair of furry, floppy ears emerged, followed by a wriggling body on gangly legs with a crazily wagging tail. Imelda had found the puppy a few weeks ago, scavenging in the bins along the promenade. He was painfully thin, and his feet were sore and bleeding. But his sorrowful gaze was irresistible, and Imelda was instantly smitten. She took him home. Shanti May had not been happy, but Alexei had been delighted. "He's a borzoi," he had declared, "a fellow Russian." "It's a dog," Shanti May had objected. "It's probably got fleas." Imelda rarely crossed her mother, but when Shanti May had told her to get rid of the puppy, she'd been adamant. "If he goes, I go with him." Shanti May had eventually yielded, fearful of losing her daughter and knowing that this was a battle she would not win. But she attempted to dignify her capitulation by disguising it as oblivion. She simply refused to acknowledge Grisha's existence and completely ignored him. Shanti May had given birth to four sons before her longed-for and only daughter eventually arrived, and it was clear from the start that Imelda had inherited her mother's independent spirit and stubborn streak. The first word she had spoken was, "No." Imelda hurried downstairs, followed closely by the now wide-awake puppy, who skittered into the kitchen and immediately sat down at the feet of Alexei, who was frying eggs for Imelda's breakfast. "You need a good meal inside you, Imelda. It's a big day." Imelda poured herself a mug of tea and sat down at the table. "Why's Mum in the Vardo?" Alexei served her two eggs on toast and smiled. "I told her not to go to the booth today, to let you have your first day as the queen bee in peace." Grisha had squeezed underneath the table and was nudging Imelda's knee with his nose. She slipped him a small piece of toast. "I take it she didn't welcome your advice, Papa?" Alexei sat down opposite her and took a deep draught from his mug of tea. "She said that I obviously thought she was an ugly, interfering old woman of no more use to anyone, and that next I'd be plotting to have her put in a home and then I'd run off with some gorger floozy." "I said, cheap gorger floozy." Shanti May was at the back door listening. She walked over to her husband and looped her arms lovingly around his neck before planting a kiss on the top of his head. "But now I forgive you, if you cook me some eggs." Imelda glanced up at the clock on the wall. It was 8 o'clock, and time for her to leave. She wanted to be at the booth early and savour every moment of her first day of sovereignty. She fed a final piece of toast to Grisha whilst her mother struggled valiantly not to notice, and then grabbed her bag, coat, and puppy and swept off down the hallway. Madame Burova was on her way. Jeannie peered into the mirror and wondered if she could get away with a bit more eyeshadow. For once, she decided not to push it. Her dad would be waiting downstairs to see her to the bus stop, and she didn't want a row to spoil today. He preferred a more natural look to what he called Jeannie's full face of slap, and even thought that her skirts should be below the knee. She'd eventually resorted to taking her lipstick and eyeliner with her and applying it on the school bus, and rolling up her skirts at the waistband after she'd left the house. Honestly, she was 16. But he treated her as though she was still a kid, even though today she was about to become a working woman. She was already planning how to spend her first pay packet after she'd given her dad some rent money. He hadn't wanted her to pay him anything at all, but she was adamant. For as long as she could remember, it had just been the two of them. He had always looked after her and put her first, and now she wanted to contribute. Maybe he might be able to buy himself something nice for a change. Top of Jeannie's list were some new nail polish and a Billie Holiday LP. She might not share her dad's views on fashion, but their taste in music was much more harmonious. Ray had raised his daughter on the greats, Etta James, Nina Simone, Ella Fitzgerald, and of course, Billie Holiday. Jeannie scrabbled through her jewellery box, pulled out a simple gold band on a chain and fastened it around her neck. It had been her mum's wedding ring, and she wanted to feel that her mum was with her today, for luck.
Jeannie, what the bleeding hell are you doing? Do you want to be late on your first day?
All right, keep your hair on, Ernie. What's left of it? What was left of her dad's hair was hidden under the peak cap of his uniform as he waited impatiently for his daughter at the foot of the stairs. Ray Rogers had been delivering milk for over 10 years and he loved his job. But since Benny Hill had topped the charts with his song about the hapless milkman, Ernie, Jeannie had not been the only one to rip him mercilessly. He clipped her playfully around the ear, she galloped down the stairs and gave him a twirl.
How do I look?
Ray shook his head and smiled wistfully. She was the image of her mother at the age when she and Ray had begun courting.
Where's my little girl gone?
You look lovely, and very grown up. Your mum would have been proud of you. It was exactly what Jeannie needed to hear, although she would never have admitted it. Her excitement was matched by apprehension. It was her first day working as a clerk at a swanky private secretarial college in town, earning her own money and making her own way in the world. Jeannie had big dreams, and this was where they began. Ray gave her a tight hug and a peck on the cheek. Come along, sweetheart. I'll walk you to the bus stop.
Didn't you look in the mirror when you got dressed this morning? Ruby Campbell raised her eyebrows at her 11-year-old son before pulling him towards her by the lapels of his blazer and releasing him so that she could straighten his crooked tie.
There, don't you look smart? Randall, look at your boy.
The husband raised his eyes from the newspaper he was reading and grinned.
He looks like a proper young man, and handsome too, just like his daddy.
Their son was, in fact, a striking blend of his parents' genes. His blonde-haired, blue-eyed mother and Jamaican father had produced a beautiful child with eyes the colour of aquamarines. But his good looks had done him no favours with his classmates, and as a new term in a new school threatened, Treasure was wary.
He smiled obligingly at his dad, but Ruby saw the doubt in her son's eyes and the knot in her stomach that she had been trying to ignore since she woke that morning, twisted and tightened just a fraction more.
Treasure was a tough little boy, small and wiry and fast as a hare. But Ruby knew that for him, life was not always easy. She remembered the no black signs in the windows of the flats that she and Randall had seen when they were hunting for their first home, and the casually cruel insults they'd endured simply for being seen together and holding hands in public. Treasure wasn't black, but he wasn't white enough for some people either, and no man's land was never a safe or comfortable place to be. She watched him struggle with a few spoonfuls of cornflakes before pushing his bowl to one side. Ruby wished that there was something that she could say or do to protect him from the bullies and the bigots, but she knew that he would have to fight his own battles and forge his own armour with whatever resources he could muster. Growing up was hard for everyone, but for kids like Treasure, it was always harder. Randall folded up his newspaper and pushed back his chair from the table.
What's in my lunchbox today, darling wife?
Ruby laughed. The same as usual, corned beef and tomato, the only thing you'll eat in your sandwiches.
Why should I have anything different when I found the perfect filling, delicious, nutritious, and fulfilling all my wishes?
Randall traded a loving kiss on his wife's cheek for his packed lunch, and on his way out of the kitchen placed both hands on Treasure's shoulders and gave them a squeeze.
Good luck, son. Have pride in yourself and you'll be fine.
Half an hour later, Treasure stood outside his new school. His stomach churned and his heart beat so hard that he could hear its frantic rhythm pounding in his head. Swept along by the mob of noisy children streaming through the gates, he had never felt so alone. Madame Burova stood in the doorway of her booth and closed her eyes. The sound of waves and swooping gulls and the chatter of passers-by washed over her. The late afternoon sun warmed her face, and a salty breeze ruffled her hair. Grisha stood beside her, his black nose twitching and his feet fidgeting, eager for a run. It had been a good day, and the cash box was almost full. A coach party of Women's Institute ladies on a day trip had kept her busy for a couple of hours,
and passing trade had been brisk. When she nipped to the cafe next door at lunchtime to pick up a coffee and a cheese roll, she'd pretended not to notice Shanti May wandering along the promenade with studied nonchalance. She hoped that her mother had seen the queue of customers waiting patiently.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.